Welcome, everyone, to an event of the Political Economy Project. My name is Jason Sorens. I'm the program director of the Political Economy Project. To find out more about the Political Economy Project and what we do, our future events, you can go to dartmouth.edu/PEP. This particular event is a project of the PEP Leadership Council, which is our student wing. And the students came up with a topic, and I helped them come up with speakers and organize the event. So without any further ado, I'd like to introduce the student who will be moderating this discussion of what killed Middle East liberalism, Matthew Zubrow.
For coming to this event. Really appreciate having you all. As Professor Soren said, my name is Matt Zubrow. I'm a senior here at Dartmouth, and just wanted to thank everyone for coming and for Professor Soren's and all involved for organizing this great event. So I have the privilege of moderating the event today. And so without further ado, let me please introduce these two distinguished scholars we have with us. Dr. Dirk J. Vandewalle is a professor of government at Dartmouth and also teaches a course on the Arab Gulf at the Amos Tuck School of Business. He's the author of two internationally acclaimed books on Libya, Libya Since Independence and a History of Modern Libya, and several edited volumes on North Africa. Dr. Vandewalle was the only Western researcher who has lived and worked in Libya for almost 15 years while the country was under U.S. and United Nations sanctions. He obtained his undergraduate degree from Southwest State University and his doctorate and a number of other degrees from Columbia University. In addition to his academic work on the politics of economic development in the Middle East and the developing world, Vandewalle has extensively written for Newsweek, The New York Times, Foreign Policy, and Foreign Affairs. Considered the leading expert on Libya in the West, his insights have been highly sought after by major media outlets across the globe, in print, radio, and television, especially after the Libyan crisis deepened in 2011 and 2012. He has appeared frequently on Al Jazeera, CNN, Charlie Rose Show, PBS NewsHour, ABC, CBS, and BBC, as well as in the Australian and European television and radio programs. Vandewalle has testified before the Senate Foreign Relations Committee on Libya and before numerous State Department committees, international agencies involved in the reconstruction of Libya. As political advisor to Ian Martin, the United Nations Special Envoy in Libya in the summer of 2011, and then became the senior political advisor to the Carter Center's electoral mission to Libya. He's appointed as a senior advisor on democratic transitions for the Carter Center's mission in Libya from 2013 to 2014, and was the center's director in Tripoli until August of 2014. He lectures and consults widely in policy and academic settings in the Middle East, Europe, and Asia. Dr. Timur Kuran is professor of economics and political science and the Gorter Family Professor of Islamic Studies at Duke University. His research focuses on social change, including the evolution of preferences and institutions, and the economic and political history and modernization of the Middle East. Dr. Kuran's work extends across many subjects beyond just economics and political science, history, religion, and legal studies, among other areas. He is a renowned expert on the relationship between Islam and development. Among his many scholarly contributions is the concept of availability cascades, which he originated with Cass Sunstein and describes a process of collective belief formation and spreading through a cyclical process of self-reinforcement. His current projects include a study of the role that the Middle East traditional institutions played in its poor political performance as measured by democratization and human liberties. Among his publications are Private Truths, Public Lies, The Social Consequences of Preference Falsification, Islam and Mammon, The Economic Predicaments of Islamism, The Long Divergence, How Islamic Law Held Back the Middle East, and a trilingual edited work that consists of 10 volumes, Social Economic Life in 7th Century Istanbul, Glimpses from Court Records. After graduating from Robert Academy in Istanbul in 1973, Kuran went on to study economics at Princeton University and Stanford University. Between 1982 and 2007, he taught at the University of Southern California. He's a member of the Institute for Advanced Study in Princeton, the John Olin Visiting Professor, the Graduate School of Business at University of Chicago, a Visiting Professor of Economics at Stanford University. He currently directs the Association for Analytic Learning about Islam and Muslim Society. He is a member of the Executive Committee of the International Economic Association, edits a book series for Cambridge University Press, serves on numerous editorial boards, and is a member of the Turkish Academy of Sciences. He has served on the World Economic Forum Arab Council. We are truly lucky to have these two gentlemen with us today, and without further ado, I would like to invite them to begin with a 15-minute opening statement. Thank you.
Thank you very much for that introduction, and thank you for Jason for arranging all of this. I was a little bit intrigued by the title of what I was supposed to talk about today, What Killed Middle East Liberalism. It's, of course, a very controversial topic. And for those of you who saw the poster, there was a little subtitle to it, The Failures of the Arab Spring Were a Long Time in the Making. And I'm going to try to take a little bit of a longer view today on what has happened in the Middle East, really going back to when the region opened up toward liberalism at the end of the night, or let's say by the beginning of the 19th century. And of course, we're all really fascinated by what has happened in the region since 2011, what we call the Arab Spring. But it is perhaps important to realize that the Arab Spring that we saw in 2010 and moving forward, was only the last in a number of uprisings that have happened within the Middle East, going back all the way to the Ottoman Empire. And so therefore, I would like to talk a little bit about kind of the structural issues that over the last 150 years or so have made liberalism somewhat suspect in the Middle East, and then draw some conclusions from that. Now, as I said, the debates about liberalism in the Middle East and North Africa, about whether liberalism is appropriate in the region and why it has failed to take hold or long-standing and have been puzzled over by scholars for a long time. Indeed, any of the students here who ever become young Middle Eastern scholars will undoubtedly have to read one of the classics in the field, a book by the late Albert Hourani called Arabic Thought in the Liberal Age, 1789 to 1939. And the premise of my talk today is that if liberalism is to succeed, and most people seem to think it has not in the Middle East, that if it has to succeed, if it has to take hold, there have to be at least two conditions. First of all, the ideas of liberalism must resonate and must be acceptable in local societies willing to defend it. And secondly, that local states must be willing or must be able to be coerced into defending liberalism. And I'll come back to this over the end of my talk, and I will argue and that except in one or two cases in the Middle East, that really has not been the case. I will concentrate primarily on Tunisia and Libya, in part because, as was mentioned, I have worked extensively both before the Arab Spring and after the Arab Spring in both countries, but also mention peripherally Morocco, which I think is also a modified success in terms of the Arab Spring. And then toward the very end of my talk, also bring in Saudi Arabia, which because of the oil revenues and so on, presents a very unique case of thinking about liberalism. Indeed, almost the impossibility of liberalism in a country like Saudi Arabia. So the takeoff point really is 1789, the French Revolution, followed by the invasion of Egypt a couple of decades later. And it was really the first time that what we call liberalism in the West, liberal ideas, and were introduced into the region. And it sparked within the Middle East and North Africa a number of reactions, in a sense, defensive reactions against these new ideas coming in. And the Ottoman Empire, which still controlled most of the territory at the time, instituted a number of reforms to try and meet these new challenges, both to reform in a sense, but also to make sure that the cohesion of the empire wasn't lost. These reforms are normally referred to as the Tanzimat, which simply means reforms, both I think in Turkish and in Arabic. And out of that initial confrontation came a wealth of writings on liberalism in the Middle East, headed or written primarily by quite, particularly if you're an expert in the region, quite well-known individuals, Jamal ad-Din al-Afghani, Muhammad Abdu, Rashid Ridda, and a number of other ones. And essentially, these were what were called at the time Islamic modernists, in part Islamic modernists because there really was no secular literature at the time. And the essential questions that they raised in thinking about liberalism and in thinking of how the region could adapt to liberalism were twofold. First of all, how should the ideal community be organized in the Middle East, and what principles should guide it? Should Sharia guide it? And secondly, what is the role of the individual versus the collectivity, the ummah, as it is called in Arabic? Now, I won't say much more about Sharia and where Sharia comes in, because my colleague, Dr. Timur, will talk about that after me. But what is interesting is that in this first attempt to reform, to move towards some kind of liberalism in the Arab world, the language that was used in Istanbul had all the earmarks, the kind of the buzzwords of liberalism. They talked about rule of law, they talked about equality, they raised some gender issues very gently. But at the same time, they also noted that the Ottoman Empire was really in decline. And the reason for this, and this is where the defensiveness comes in, and I'm sure my colleague will have to say much more about that, they said the Ottoman Empire was in decline, so you have the liberal buzzwords on the one hand, and then the empire was in decline because the sacred Sharia was not obeyed. It is evident that countries not governed by the Sharia cannot survive. And that, of course, is one of the major issues that has dominated this debate and continues to dominate this debate until then. Now, let me turn specifically to Tunisia, because in Tunisia, these reforms were taken in. Tunisia, in many ways, particularly the intellectual class, had started to be educated in France. Remember that by 1881, France occupied, had a protectorate over Tunisia, but had been in Tunisia quite a bit before that. And the reforms had really started under a previous ruler, Ahmed Bey, in Tunis. And the reforms, again, included all these kinds of buzzwords of liberalism: security, civil liberty, regular taxation, conscription, the right of Jews and foreigners to own land, etc. And the man who came to kind of symbolize the reforms in Tunisia was a man called Khairedin al-Tunisi. And Khairedin al-Tunisi had been minister for the Bey and was trying to come to terms with how he could marry liberalism on the one hand, you know, which was really, for all practical purposes, an almost medieval society at the time. And he wrote a number of books on it, one called The Surest Path, which was essentially The Surest Path referred to the ability to figure out what the best way was to govern a local society, that there was a religious connotation there. And then, since, of course, as an elite in Tunisia, in the Maghreb, in North Africa at the time, he was perfectly bilingual, he also wrote a book in French called A Mes Enfants, To My Children, where again he tried to get across the kind of what he thought should be the guiding principles of government that would bring liberalism into the country. In 1861, Tunisia adopted, as the first country in the Arab world, a constitution, and it was, by all indications, a liberal constitution. And it was followed very quickly afterwards, or relatively quickly afterwards, by the creation of a republic in Tripoli. So that roughly by, let's say, the beginning of the 20th century, we had two emerging areas in the Middle East, North Africa, the Middle East, where liberalism was part and parcel of the political language. And then something very dramatic happens. One country is destined to remain liberal, and one country is destined to become despotic. And of course, what happened was colonialism. The French were very interested, because of the mission civilisatrice and whatever else that they used to explain their presence in North Africa. We're very interested both in education, we're very interested in helping these internal movements move forward. They incorporated a lot of Tunisians into their bureaucracy and into their administration. And in a sense, colonialism, as it often was, became a double sword in this fight for liberalism in the Middle East. On the one hand, as I will shortly tell you about, it produced people like Habib Bourguiba, who would become the first president of Tunisia, very liberal-minded, made all kinds of liberal reforms that I'll talk about in a second. But on the other hand, of course, colonialism also introduced sectarianism and the support of sectarianism, divide and rule policies that in many ways made a liberal society more difficult to imagine for local people. So in a sense, Tunisia was lucky. Now, when you look at Tunisia, these ideas that Khairedin had talked about, you know, 40, 50 years earlier, became re-inculcated into the political dialogue, into what was known as the Young Tunisians. And the Young Tunisians was really the first political movement, almost semi-nationalist movement in Tunisia, and led to the creation of what eventually became the party that would lead the country to independence, the so-called Destour Party. Now, Destour, the word was deliberately chosen. Destour means constitution in Arabic. And so they wanted, again, to convey the you know, the thought that they were very liberal. And under the Destour Party, Tunisia created a cadre of dedicated modernist bureaucrats, of which, of course, Habib Bourguiba, who became the president, was the most important. Bourguiba himself was a lawyer trained in Paris, and certainly was very interested to bring to Tunisia a rule of law and a whole bunch of other reforms that would curtail, first of all, the power of the ulama, the religious scholars, and a number of other administrative changes, again, very much in a liberal fashion. The whole Tunisian experiment, in fact, was underpinned by a dedication to liberalism. At the same time that Bourguiba was trying to create a modern state with a clear social contract between the state and Tunisian society. And it's this system, you know, going all the way back into the 1840s, 1850s, the Khairedin era, it's really this system that will survive with occasional setbacks, and I don't mean to underplay those. You know, Tunisia at times was very undemocratic, was very illiberal in many ways, particularly as Bourguiba himself became, he called himself combattant suprême, the supreme combatant, and appointed himself president to life and for life. And then, of course, in 1987, there was the coup. But despite that, and I would argue, Tunisia really emerged more or less as a liberal country when the event of 2010, which started the Arab Spring, took place. If we look at Morocco, for example, we see more or less the same pattern. The kind of incorporation of elites into the bureaucratic and administrative centers of the country, a very gradual diminishing of some of the impact of the ulama and of the religious centers. The Karawiyin Mosque, for example, in Fez lost a lot of its importance, much like the Zaytuna Mosque, which also had been the center of traditional learning in Tunisia, had lost its role. And Morocco eventually became almost like Tunisia, but for quite different reasons. We can talk about it in the question and answer session, also somewhat a model of a liberal reforming country. Now, in Libya, of course, we had the exact opposite. In Libya, once the Italians invaded in 1911, what we saw was really the destruction of whatever state institutions, embryonic state institutions, existed at the time, and the end of that liberal experiment that Tripoli had started, the Tripoli Republic of 1918. And in a sense, Libya will never recover from this. The country will never really emerge as a truly unified state. And of course, all of this will be exacerbated once Gaddafi takes over in 1969 and then starts using oil money very strategically to promote his own vision of this kind of stateless society that he had in mind. And so when the Arab Spring comes around in 2010, Tunisia, certainly not conflict-free, eventually will adopt a new constitution that remains essentially liberal, despite the fact that as part of new Tunisian politics, we now have the presence of, again, an Islamic modernist, Rashid al-Ranouchi, and the Nahda party that come to power in Tunisia. But in Tunisia, what was interesting was that political compromise in the end prevailed. And it could only prevail because it had that kind of long history going back into the 19th century, and of course the presence of people like Bourguiba and the Destour party. And the existing political arrangements in Tunisia therefore allowed for a consensus to emerge. In Libya, on the other hand, without any real state institutions and without anything close to a social contract the way it had emerged in Tunisia, the system simply imploded once the rebellion against Gaddafi took place. Gaddafi, of course, was replaced. And what we saw was that primordial politics rapidly reemerged in Libya. So we see two differential responses to what has happened in the Arab Spring. My point here is that you really have to understand the kind of structural impediments to liberalism to understand why one country was relatively successful, why the other one was. And so in conclusion, then let me make three comments about the possibility of liberalism in the future in the Arab world. As I said at the beginning of my talk, I think announcing the death of liberalism in the Middle East is perhaps a bit premature. In light of what I've said, I'm certainly not arguing here that we're likely to see the kind of blossoming Westminster-style democracy that we would like to see, but perhaps that is not the best way to think about what to expect of liberalism in the region. I think Tunisia, especially, is a good example of where a perfect storm of factors, ranging all the way going back to Haradin, incorporating the Neo-Destour, incorporating Bourguiba, incorporating the Islamist party after the uprising, where for all these reasons, Tunisia really emerged with a relatively liberal form of government. Where effective state building, as in Tunisia, proceeded, there was more rule of law, more institutional development that allowed for the emergence of a liberal social contract between state and society. Although undoubtedly some of the ideas and sentiments that have underpinned the Arab Spring will remain alive, they have been alive after all for almost 200 years, the larger conditions necessary to give liberalism a more robust presence will take much longer to put into place in the region. Liberalism presumes a whole bunch of internal institutional developments and underpinnings that I think simply don't exist in several countries of the Middle East today. And then finally, to get back to the question of what did kill liberalism, let me just point out very quickly a number of what I would call enabling conditions that in many ways made governments or regimes virtually invulnerable to pressures from local societies. And these range from the fact that there was a lot of oil money, which really made particularly countries in the Gulf really not responsible at all before their citizens, to selectively, as I've pointed out, colonialism, great power intervention during the Cold War, and finally, I would argue, in a case like Saudi Arabia, an alliance with the Wahhabis, a very conservative Islamic movement that obviously has precluded any movement toward liberalism. So there's a bit of hope. It's not all a negative picture about liberalism in the Middle East, but certainly there's quite a long way to go before some of the major countries will perhaps turn into a more liberal path. Thanks very much.
Thank you very much for inviting me to this event, and it's particularly wonderful to be in a part of the country that has a moderate climate. There is this morning, when I left Durham, North Carolina, there was much more snow on the ground than there is here. So it's also warmer. So there have been liberal movements in the Middle East, as we just heard, movements aimed at expanding economic, social, and political liberties. And as we heard, they go back at least to the 19th century, The Arab Spring is the latest example of a flourishing of liberties. But liberalism has never been strong in the Middle East. Egyptian liberals were happy to see off Mubarak, but they were quickly suppressed, and Mubarak's replacement is arguably much worse. Civil society is the part of a social system that lies outside direct state control. It is absolutely essential to a liberal order, but historically, civil society has been weak in the Middle East, and the institutions that have accounted historically for the weaknesses of civil society still cast a shadow on the Middle East today. I want to stress two problems that are not discussed in the popular press. The popular press tends to focus on the proximate causes. I want to focus on the deeper forces, in fact, going back in history, going back even further than Professor Vandewalle did. But I want to assure you that the factors that I'm going to put on the table do have implications for the present, and I hope that we can get to them in Q&A. So the two problems are that the provision that social services were provided by politically powerless organizations, not by nonprofit corporations as in Europe historically, and secondly, historically, the private commercial sector in the Middle East consisted of tiny ephemeral companies. There were no large companies until the 20th century, or profit-making corporations. Why is this important? Because you didn't have economic players that could constrain the state. So let me start with the first of these. Historically, social services in the Middle East were provided through trusts called waqfs. Wealthy people endowed land or buildings to finance a social service. A waqf-based Islamic college, for example, or a madrasa, was backed by assets, backed by farms, by shops. The income from these farms and shops were used to maintain it. And there are many examples in the region that are alive even today. Practically every building in the United States, pre-19th century building that is still standing, with the exception of palaces that were built by sultans and fortresses that were built by armies, is a waqf. So here's an example from the city of my youth, Istanbul, the center of Istanbul. Every building you see here is work. Every building, with the exception of this building, which is a 19th century building, every single one of these was a waqf. So here you have a bathhouse for women, a bathhouse for men, endowed as a waqf, the corner of a big mosque. This was a school. This park itself was financed, except for the water feature, which is a 20th century addition. This park itself has been maintained for many centuries through a separate waqf. The waqf protected property rights through the common belief that waqf assets are sacred. And this belief made rulers, going all the way back to the 8th century, reluctant to confiscate waqf assets lest they develop a reputation for impiety. The income of a waqf was spent, as I pointed out, at least partly on financing the chosen service. So if you built a waqf to finance a bathhouse, part of the income of the assets went to that. But the waqf founders benefited personally from the shielding of wealth because the law allowed them to manage the sheltered assets themselves in return to fees and also to designate the beneficiaries. So some of the assets they set aside returned to them and their families. Why is this important? Because it created enormous incentives across the entire region to place wealth in waqfs. Vast wealth flowed over a millennium into endowing waqfs, serving many ends, mosques and religious schools, but also non-religious services such as fountains, inns for merchants, soup kitchens. You see another example here from Cairo on this screen. The goal in setting these up was partly, if not largely, to shelter wealth from rulers. The share of real estate controlled by waqfs grew over time. By the 19th century, depending on the location, between 25 and 50% of all real estate was out of state controlled, was controlled by these waqfs. Now, why is this so critical to understanding the present? Given that waqfs came to control vast resources securely, they might have become powerful political players. They might have constrained the state in the Arab world, in Iran, in Turkey, elsewhere, by resisting actions harmful to their constituencies. The resulting decentralization, these waqfs, these thousands of waqfs all across the region were founded independently and controlled independently by different families. They might have placed the Middle East on the road to liberalism and democratization. In Western Europe, cities and guilds and universities organized as nonprofit corporations or charitable corporations served exactly that political function that the waqfs might have served. In constraining central governments, they became agents of democratization. However, for all their wealth, waqfs remained politically powerless, absolutely powerless, for several reasons. They had to deliver specified services and use resources according to fixed instructions. Unlike corporations, they had no standing in court as an organization. Waqfs could not use, it's very important, could not use resources for political ends. This is unlike an incorporated European city or an incorporated European church. European cities, churches, guilds were free to participate in politics. A waqf was not. And finally, whereas the constituents of a corporation could replace a poorly performing leader, like city dwellers replacing a poorly performing mayor, the constituents of a waqf had no say over the caretaker. And the caretaker was not accountable to them. If he was monitored at all, it was by the state. The bottom line is that in the Middle East, the suppliers of social services, and these were waqfs, these were not municipalities. There were no municipalities in the region until the second half of the 19th century. They did not constrain sultans, nor did they foster political movements or ideologies. Which brings us to civil society in the region. We remind you, these are associations, these consist of associations that stand between the state and the individual. Since the 20th century, it has been possible in the region to form private associations. The necessary laws have existed since 1908 in the region, although in some places they are being revoked today. In Egypt, there's a bill on Sisi's desk that would effectively kill Egypt's already very weak civil society. Even where civil society is being eviscerated, however, even places like Egypt, there are people with some experience in organizing privately, in running private organizations, in financing private campaigns. Those experiences may prove useful in the future, even in cases like Egypt that are currently facing extraordinarily fierce repression and extraordinarily fierce repression on the part of the state. But the associational rights and organizational rights that evolved in Europe over a millennium have been developing in the region for only a century, and even less in some places. Looked at from a long perspective, a perspective of more than a millennium, the Middle East is at the early stages of learning how to constrain states through private associations and organizations. People are not yet accustomed to running private organizations or expecting their leaders to be accountable. When citizens have problems, they don't think instinctively of organizing privately to solve them. When you have a problem in the region, what you think of first is, who do I know in a high place who can solve it? You think in terms of personal connections, not in terms of looking for people who have similar problems and forming an organization. Now, this is not to say that states are strong in the Middle East. Weak civil society does not imply a strong state. States are weak, first, because they can't solve all social problems on their own. States, much stronger states in Europe and North America are strong partly because they rely on a strong civil society to help them solve social problems. States in the Middle East don't have the information to solve social problems. They don't have the capabilities. Mass discontent is an obvious consequence. States are weak, secondly, because the Middle East entered the modern era with a culture of corruption that was caused in large measure by WACs. The rigidity of the WACs created incentives to evade the rules of the WACs, and evasions required bribing state officials for routine adjustments. Where laws are commonly evaded, it's hard to get people to obey new laws, which is the essence of modernization. Since everyone breaks the law, everyone has been doing this for generations, the act carries no significant stigma, and enforcement is costly. Consequently, laws enforced at low cost elsewhere don't get enforced. The other historical reason why the Middle East remains largely illiberal has to do with its commercial sector. Until the 20th century, profit-making enterprises in the region were tiny and short-lived. Commercial enterprises in the region, this surprises many people when they hear it, until the 20th century, commercial enterprises with five or more members were rare, and none of them lived for more than a few years. For centuries, however, Europe had been forming trading companies and banks as perpetual organizations through capital provided by hundreds of investors. All large profit-making companies in the Middle East that existed at the beginning of the 20th century were either foreign-founded or they received substantial foreign help, and often they were headquartered not in the region but in Europe. Two Islamic institutions, laws that are part of what is known as the Sharia, accounted for the pattern and its persistence. First, resources were pooled through Islamic commercial partnerships. A partnership member could pull out at any time unilaterally. The partnership's premature dissolution, which was possible at any time, imposed costs on other partners who wanted to stay in. So merchants and investors minimized the risks of premature dissolution of enterprises by keeping their partnerships small and short-lived. The second institution that has mattered enormously, that mattered because it kept enterprises small and short-lived, is the Islamic inheritance system. The Islamic inheritance system is egalitarian by pre-modern standards. Because of this egalitarianism, sudden death of a member of a partnership forced remaining partners to deal with a large number of heirs. They tended to be numerous. It's typically not a single heir, like the oldest son of the deceased partner, as would have been the case typically in Europe. So merchants and investors kept partnerships small and short-lived, also to minimize the probability of dealing with many heirs. Jointly, these institutions played a role in the Middle East economic underdevelopment. But it's the political consequences that is relevant here. Tiny and ephemeral Middle Eastern businesses could not bargain with the state, as large firms in the Middle East, in Western Europe, did in the centuries leading up to the Industrial Revolution. And their lack of permanence inhibited the formation of business associations. That too hindered the development of civil society. If you look at the history during the second millennium of democratization and liberalization in Western Europe, you will see that business associations played an important role. You didn't have analogous associations in the Middle East, so there were no commercial organizations that could bargain with sultans and effectively constrain them. So it's time to conclude before we turn to Q&A. The roots of the weaknesses of contemporary liberalism in the Middle East lie in Islamic institutions, specific Islamic institutions, not in Islamic theology or in the Islamic belief system. I want to emphasize that. Islamic beliefs have been quite flexible over the past 14 centuries. They remain quite flexible today. Part of the reason is that Islam as a religion is decentralized. There's no Islamic Vatican to keep beliefs homogeneous. Islamic liberalism has remained weak because institutional checks and balances in the region are weak, and they are weak for historical reasons. Thank you.
Thank you. It's not a rebuttal at all, actually. I was just kind of struck by Timur's presentation and how in many ways we're approaching the same, obviously the same problems, but from very different angles. But in a sense, we're coming to some of the same conclusions. And the one that struck me, first of all, was when Timur was talking about the lack of civil society and the lack of associational life. That has really marked the region for a very long time. And associated to that, what also struck me was when you said that, in a sense, Middle East and North Africa, MENA, finds itself kind of at the beginning of the learning curve in a sense of coming to terms with more liberal, hopefully more liberal societies. And that is certainly something that I would reiterate also. The analogy, of course, or the inquiry and whether or not states are weak or strong is, of course, one that political scientists have dealt with for quite a while. It always reminds me of the book by Nazeh Ayoubi, who really looked at this very carefully and said, Middle East states are neither weak nor strong, and they're fierce, meaning they have a coercive capability, but very little beyond that. So what you have is some kind of a hollow shell, in a sense. You have a very powerful ruler and a very, in many instances, very small supporting circles, and civil society, the population as a whole, is left to fend for itself, particularly also in economic, the kind of phenomenon that Timur was describing about small companies and so on was obviously something you found in Tunisia and in Libya as well, and to a large extent still has not changed, but in Libya, particularly in Tunisia, it has changed. Obviously, I also very much agree with Timur what he said about what the kind of the political impact is of all of this. The kind of atomistic behavior that you start developing in these countries, the rule of law that remains absent to a large extent. I guess if we were to slightly differ, it would be that Timur obviously thinks that Islamic institutions are at the bottom of why MENA, the Middle East and North Africa, remains illiberal. I would, as you have heard me do, tie it a bit more to state building and to the lack of institutional checks and balances that exist if state building doesn't really proceed. So with that, Timur, let me give it to you.
I too thought that, Thank you. So I too thought that our presentations were quite complementary, and there is the issue itself is so big. I think each of us could have spoken for many, many hours, and we ended up picking facets of the issue that complement that thought each other very well. I want to pick up on some things that Dirk said and that immediately resonated with me. First of all, he pointed out toward the end of his talk that we need to understand the structural impediments to liberalization in the region. I completely agree with this. I think we need to distinguish, though, between factors that are specific to particular countries or to a particular subregion or to a particular group of countries and those that are common to the entire region. Okay. Oil is often mentioned as a factor. And certainly oil contributes to corruption. It weakens civil society by allowing states like Saudi Arabia, like Libya and until recently, to buy off oppositions. This is certainly a factor in those places. But we need to recognize that we don't have liberalization or successful liberalization in parts of the Middle East that don't have oil, that don't have minerals, period. Yemen is a good example. And of course, there are many. Turkey is a country that imports 98% of its oil. So again, that is a factor that complements a broader explanation, but it is not the critical factor. There are ethnic and sectarian divisions in some society that contribute to the problems. Building a democracy, a liberal democracy in Iraq, is made harder by the fact that you have sectarian divisions, the Sunni-Shia division, as well as ethnic division, the Arab-Kurdish division being the primary one. But you don't have flourishing liberal movements in places that are more homogeneous religiously and that don't have the same ethnic or for that matter, linguistic divisions. So I think that when we're trying to explain why the Middle East is the least democratized, least free part of the world today, including sub-Saharan Africa, we have to look for some common elements. And I have tried to focus on or draw attention to two historical factors that have kept civil society weak. And I've tried to draw attention to the fact that civil society started developing in the region only very, very recently. So that's one point I wanted to make. Second thing that resonated with me that Dirk said is that if liberalism is to succeed, two conditions are needed. And if I took correct notes, the first was that the ideas of liberalism must resonate. Now here this raises a puzzle. And the puzzle is that when you look at the world values surveys conducted out of the University of Michigan in a number of countries, including countries of the Middle East and North Africa, we find when people are asked questions about democracy that people are very favorable to democracy. In fact, in Saudi Arabia, a larger percentage of people are favorable to democracy than in the United States. They consider it the best of all systems. So this is puzzle, and these are, I should point out that these, I've had long discussions with the people who, with the teams that that did these surveys? Did they give people who participated in the surveys, did they give them anonymity and so on? It turns out they were extremely careful to do this. Could there have been other biases and so on? Anyway, these are the World Value Survey. It's a very serious operation, and they've done what they could to provide anonymity. And the World Value Survey's results or findings are not outliers. Other polling organizations find similar results elsewhere. So what is exactly going on? People mean different things from democracy. When you say, ask a Saudi citizen, which of these systems is the best? They pick democracy because they think of a system that will give more freedoms to them. I will be able to drive finally. My wife will be able to drive, and therefore she'll be able to work. They are not thinking, that democracy is a system that will give more, that gives more freedom to others, that also recognizes minority rights. You can be freer to speak, you can be freer to look at whatever you want on the internet, but that gives the same right to others. When you define democracy, when you tell them that democracy also includes more freedom for others, the numbers go way, way down. Okay, so this is, and it's really not surprising in places where people don't have a history of an experience with democracy, they don't know much about it. They hear that democracy is a place where you have more freedoms, and they answer accordingly. So a big challenge is in terms of. In relation to this precondition, I agree, this is a very important precondition, is that tolerance toward others is something that has to be cultivated. That doesn't emerge easily. It didn't emerge easily in Europe. Protestants and Catholics didn't easily come to an agreement that they could coexist. They could live together, and as we're seeing today in the United States and in Europe, it's quite easy to destroy any tolerance that exists, even in countries that we consider advanced democracies today. Tolerance is quite shallow. People, and we're beginning to see that. So finally, let me just say that one of the implications of what I think both Dirk and I are saying is that there is no quick fix in the region. Okay, and this is something that I have when I'm asked by journalists or people want an answer. People want a quick soundbite of what is needed in the region that will suddenly. Turn these countries into Jeffersonian democracies? And my answer is that don't expect that. That's not going to happen in your lifetime. It's not going to happen in my lifetime. We're not going to see these Jeffersonian democracies. We have to think of incremental reforms, and we have to think of specific institutions. We have to identify them, and there's the road to genuine liberalism that the region can be proud of is something that is for the distant future. Thanks.
All right, now we're going to have a Q&A open to the audience. So if you'd like to ask a question, please come to the aisle. Ryan Chen
I have a question for Professor Kuran. I appreciate that you spoke about a vast time period and space, and we gave you about 11 minutes, and so I don't want to put words into your mouth, but when you describe Waqfs, am I pronouncing that right?
Yes, yes.
You described a lot of commonalities among them, in a sense, you know, things that they, properties that they share that have made them ineffective at checking state authority. Given the time period, the space period, and the decentralization kind of flexibility of Islam, I would have expected that there would be great diversity in the structure of Waqfs and in the role that they played. And, you know, maybe that diversity got compressed by necessity in the amount of time and space you had. But I wanted to ask you, would I be right to infer that they have a kind of a uniform structure and have played a similar role across all these different polities? Or is there more diversity than you had time to talk about in your first statements?
No, there is more diversity, and there were also differences in the percentage of wealth that went into the Waqf. So they played a more important role in holding back civil society in some places than others. I'll give you just one example of differences, major differences across the region. I mentioned that the founder of a Waqf could appropriate some of the income by appointing himself or herself the trustee, by placing family members in various positions, giving them fancy salaries and so on. But they also had to provide a social service. How much, where was the line drawn? Well, there's nothing in there's no text that specifies, that provides an upper limit to how much you can appropriate. This varied from one region to another. The norms were in some places that the judge who would ratify the Waqf deed wouldn't allow it, wouldn't consider it legitimate if you were going to be appropriating more than 30% of the income. In other places, you could go up to 70%. Now, our research on this subject is still in its infancy. I'm encouraging students to go, doctoral students, to start making these comparisons and see whether we can find differences in attitudes depending on what these norms were. So you're absolutely right. There were some variety. There is some heterogeneity there, but the basic argument that the Waqf was an inflexible organization, that it did not play a political role, this is common to the entire region. Yeah.
Can I move? Just following up on what Timur said, of course, obviously these Waqfs were the Wukuf in general, were very powerful economic entities. And so particularly in North Africa, as soon as particularly in Tunisia, Algeria, Morocco, and in Libya in a very different sense, one of the main attempts that was made when these countries became independent was to liberate Waqf from their religious conduct and to bring him under state control. And so what I talked about, the removal of the Zaytuna Mosque, for example, in Tunis, the same phenomenon in Morocco and so on, all of this was meant to, in a sense, to bring Waqf property under state control. Very, very difficult and led to all kinds of recriminations and so on, a process that to some extent is still going on. And I'm not sure how Egypt dealt with the Waqf and how that was.
Well, in Egypt, there was a series of nationalizations under Muhammad Ali. Then the second big wave came under Nasser. And all properties owned by Waqfs, except for those owned by mosques, most mosques, I should say, and a few religious schools like Al-Azhar, they were nationalized. Okay, so in Turkey, the process started with the Tanzimat, And it was completely finished by Atatürk's regime by 1925 or so. All of these, in Turkey's case, even the waqfs, using the Turkish word, the vakufs that that controlled mosques were nationalized, and their resources were pooled in a state agency. So they're not the waqf is not an obstacle to the development of civil society directly today, because the waqf sector is very, very small these days. But they cast the shadow, the historical waqf casts a shadow on the present, because there's no major tradition of organizing privately to constrain the state.
This question is primarily directed at Professor Kuran. You outlined civil society as kind of a crucial deficiency for the growth of liberalism. While there's not any quick fixes, as you mentioned, I'm wondering what your thoughts would be on, presumably that would imply that developing civil society and making it a more robust presence would help to create an environment in which liberalism can flourish. I'm wondering what your thoughts are on how to make a supportive environment for civil society, and specifically what role, if any, international aid organizations should play in that development.
Very good, good question. I think given that, if you accept that a major deficiency of the Middle East is that the private sector is weak, then what international aid organizations and countries providing aid to the region can do is to channel aid to private organizations, not the state. Most aid to the region now is, of course, military aid, goes straight to the armies, and what's not military aid goes to the state. And the little aid that goes to private organizations tends, in places like Egypt, to go to organizations set up by the state to look like private organizations to apply for international funding. So quasi-civil society organizations or quasi-private organizations, but really the state is behind them, and they're serving the state and providing rents to high officials. U.S. embassies and other foreign embassies know very well, and international aid organizations, which organizations, private organizations in Egypt, have been set up by the government. They go along, they should not be going along with this game. They should be directing dollars insofar as they're sending in dollars for non-military purposes to genuine private organizations, but often for strategic reasons, because of military considerations, they just go along with the games of dictators in the region.
Hello, thank you very much. I am from the Sultanate of Oman, which, as you may be aware, is the last absolute monarchy in the world. Can you hear me now?
Yes.
I am from the Sultanate of Oman, which you may be aware is the last absolute monarchy in the world. What is your outlook of Oman in terms of liberalism and the Arab Gulf region as a whole? Thank you.
Well, I mean, virtually all of the Gulf countries in many ways are very exclusionary political systems. it's really the only area in the world where you really truly have ruling monarchs still in power in all six of the GCC countries, including Oman. And you're absolutely right. Oman is really kind of at the cusp. It's really the last one to come in to the community of nations, so to speak. It really opened up in the 1970s. I think what this means is that a lot of what Timur was also talking about, the control of civil society and so on, is very strong in these countries. As a matter of fact, a lot of the NGOs are actually created by the state itself. They're not even created within society a lot of times. So what this means is, and particularly for your country, because from what I understand, the Sultan doesn't have a successor. So there's a real issue there. And so what it means that you live in a country, in a sense, where there are no political guidelines, and you know, could be really problematic. And from what I understand, there's already some infighting among certain of the relatives of the Sultan over succession and so on. So certainly Oman, I think, is in for probably a pretty rough ride. The problem for the rest of the Gulf has essentially been that until now, and probably for some time into the future, there's really been enough money to keep in place some very careful patronage systems that, you know, keep the political balance. You know, it's a kind of an almost classic divide and rule. And, you know, where the political bargain, the social contract, in a sense, is that, you know, we will provide you with everything you need, but in return, you know, you really have no political voice in the system. And I don't see that changing very rapidly. As you know, Saudi Arabia is trying to reform its economy and bring in more entrepreneurs and so on, brought in specifically for that purpose a young prince to do that. How successful that will be in a system where everybody depends on handouts, and, you know, where roughly, depending on the numbers you use, 10,000 princes and princesses depend on that kind of system. Whether or not you can really reform that is really very, very problematic, I think. So I wish you all the best in Oman.
This is an excellent answer, so I can be very brief. Unfortunately, Oman is one of two countries in the region, I'm embarrassed to say, that I have not been to, so I cannot say anything specifically about Oman. Let me just add one thing concerning Saudi Arabia. There's an enormous population pressure, and this applies to other GCC countries as well. As long as oil prices were high, this wasn't a big problem. The additional people could also be bought off. This is becoming increasingly difficult. The Saudis know that they're in a race against time, that they have to find jobs for millions of people, and they know that unless they give them skills, good skills, they're not going to be able to provide the jobs. I think they've started too late to be successful in the foreseeable future. I think that we're probably going to see a lot of political trouble in the GCC, starting with Saudi Arabia.
Yeah, and just going back to a point that you made earlier, Timur, about the kind of the expectations and the mindset of people, particularly in Saudi Arabia, everybody wants to be in the kafil system. You know, they want to be managers. No one really wants a real job. So that's a real problem as well. And so what you have in Saudi Arabia is literally tens of thousands of people with PhDs who have no productive job. You go into a bank in Saudi Arabia, you may see 30 tellers standing there. Some of them are extremely well educated. You know, but no real jobs. And so the expectations are extremely high. And as you said, they have to do something there because, and you were absolutely right, if Saudi Arabia continues the way it does with the deficits and the oil prices the way it is, literally within 2.5 years, and they're already spending $100 billion a year out of deficit every year. They're, you know, even with all the reserves they have, they're in very serious difficulties.
Just to add to this, yes, there are some very educated, well-educated people who are serving as tellers because the jobs don't exist, but there are also some people who consider themselves well-educated but are not well-educated. They want to be managers, they have degrees from some university, but they don't speak a foreign language, they don't have many skills, and you have hundreds of thousands of these people. And this is just a ticking time bomb. And I might add here that it's also a big social problem because until they get a good job and obtain some status, they can't get married. And that, of course, creates a great deal of frustration. And you also have a lot of women who are not getting married because they're not enough eligible men. So you have the marriage age in the region is rising, creating huge frustrations. It's a problem in other countries as well, Egypt as well, yeah.
Thanks to the two of you very much for some really stimulating and thought-provoking comments. And I guess my question is about tribalism, which I think neither of you has really addressed in your 11-minute presentations that John referenced. And so I'm wondering whether tribalism remains a very important source of sort of social coordination, political coordination, patronage, and can you have a liberal, does a liberal country have to be individualistic, or can we imagine the development of a liberal country that remains a strongly tribalistic one?
So tribalism is a matter of degree. We have, of course, we have in every society special attachments to our sub-communities defined sometimes by bloodlines, or defined by religion, defined by where we came from. So we're all, to one degree or another, partial toward people who came from parts of the world that that we know, where we grew up. But in societies that have advanced democracies, that have had successful democracies, this sort of tribalism is generally quite weak. And it doesn't become a huge political problem. In countries like Iraq, where law and order doesn't exist, where the state has failed, people turn to their tribes for security. And tribal feelings become much, much stronger, and where resources are also scarce, fights over resources then turn into feuds that get out of hand. And this is what we've seen in not only in Iraq, but Syria as well, Libya too, also. I think tribalism is a problem in the region. It's something that does get suppressed when you have an effective state. So I don't think this is something that can't be overcome. And if you look at the history of the region, you have, even in places like Lebanon, which we think of in reference to tribalism, it's at a civil war where people divided along sectarian and ethnic lines, were at each other's throats for years. Lebanon had periods of peace for hundreds of years. If you are certain that there is a state that will punish tribes that exercise violence against others, then you don't do it. And then you learn that you can treat people as individuals, that they're not going to harm you because you're from a different tribe. So I don't think there might be, we might hear different view now, but I don't think this is a fundamental problem. Strengthening the state and making the state serve the people, which requires appropriate checks and balances, that is more critical, I think.
Well, I think it's a very difficult question to answer, and you know, I think somebody, an anthropologist, for example, would look at this very, very different than I would look at it. But as a political scientist, I would likely argue along the lines of what Timur said, that under normal circumstances where the state is in control, or in the case of Libya, for example, you have somebody like Gaddafi, you know, in an authoritarian fashion who holds it down, the role of tribes had very steadily declined over the last 60, 70 years or so. In part also because there was an enormous amount of urbanization that took place in the region, you know, which brought different tribes into, for example, in Libya, you have in Benghazi, you have one tribe that actually comes from a different part of a country. So, you know, the role of the tribes disappeared more or less, didn't quite disappear, but at least was quite substantially lessened. But then what we saw, particularly in Libya, was that as soon as the conflict broke out, and as I said, that there was this kind of implosion, that tribal identity became very important again for the perpetuation of the conflict, that these tribes were starting to identify with certain of the militias and so on. So I think Timur is right, in times of crises, that kind of primordial identity resurfaces a lot of times. And certainly Libya and also Yemen has been a very good example of that in the last 2-3 years.
And this isn't, this is very well put, this isn't unique to the Middle East. Look at the Balkans. In the Balkans, under Tito, the Yugoslav identity became very strong, and intermarriages between Bosniaks and Serbs and Croats and Albanians went way up. Then when Yugoslavia fell apart, these primordial identities became stronger, and in some cases, families that were mixed families broke up because the tribalist feelings became too strong to handle.
But I don't think we answered your last question, which had to do with, could you have a country with a tribal system and still be liberal? Was that the question?
Or do you have to have individualism of some robust kind in order to have a liberal society?
At some level, you have to have individualism. You have to recognize the individualism. And with regard to the Middle East, I don't see any problem there because traditionally, the state recognizes the individual. An Islamic court recognizes only individuals, not even corporate personalities, not even families don't have standing in an Islamic court. So, individualism is very much, at least legally, part of the fabric in the Middle East. But in general, I don't think you can have liberalism unless you recognize the individual as the fundamental unit of society.
We have time for one more question.
Hi. I would like you to comment, both professors, on the migrant crisis, refugee migrant crisis, and how it affects liberalism, how you see the changes in political structures in the Middle East. Does it in what way? For example, Libya was the hub for illegal immigrants and, yeah.
Yeah. Yes, and of course, Libya has kind of emerged as one of the centers for illegal immigration. But it, in a sense, is the same phenomenon as what you're seeing in Europe in many ways, you know, that the migration and the number, the sheer number of migrants is really putting an enormous amount of pressure on local regimes. And what we've seen in Europe is that a lot of political activity on the far right, on the right and the far right, has really been to kind of claim that as their own, you know, and make that a political issue. So it really has influenced Europe. But the same has happened in Libya, for example. You see these kinds of denunciations of migrants, and sometimes in very violent terms. So if you're already in a very stressful situation, and you know the country is already divided up, you know, among 600 militias and so on, and then you add this extra burden of
illegal migration and the fact that certain militias and certain tribes then start to monopolize the trades in the migrants. I mean, it's a recipe for disaster. And again, for that, Libya has been a very good example as well, I think.
So migration creates stresses both in the feeding regions, like the parts of Syria, parts of Libya that are the origins where the migrants originate, and the receiving regions. And the receiving regions include not just Western Europe, but also large areas in the Middle East and North Africa itself. There are 3 million Syrian immigrants in Turkey. There are huge numbers. This is the largest number of Syrian refugees in the region, but proportionally you have even more in Jordan and Lebanon. They create enormous stresses because they tend to move to areas where social services are already inadequate. In some of the places where they're settled, an example is Gaziantep in Turkey, not far from the Syrian border. In parts of the province, the Syrian immigrants now outnumber the original residents. And of course, as you can imagine, this creates competition for jobs, wages fall, and you get a lot of tensions between locals and the immigrants. And so this is something that adds to existing stresses.
Great, thank you so much for coming. Thank you to our esteemed panelists. And please, if you have any questions about the Political Economy Project or would like to get involved, please contact one of us and we'd be happy to connect you. So here, let's have a round of applause for our